Hello everyone. In this video, we will be covering sections 2.1 and 2.2, which is frequency distributions and two types of graphs. So let's start with a frequency distribution. So we're going to learn how to create one. So we're going to learn how to create a frequency distribution. You're going to learn what is a class boundary. You're going to learn actually what is a class, how to find the relative frequency, and how to find the midpoint and the cumulative frequency. So usually you're given a data set like this one. So the question has to specify how many classes it wants. So in this case, it clearly says that it wants four classes. Okay. Well, so what is a class and how do we find them? So the first thing you need to do is find something called the range. And the range is just the distance between the smallest and the biggest number. For this, it's a very good idea to have the numbers from the smallest to the biggest. So if they are not like this, it's better to put it in order or ascending order. So in this case, the maximum is 19. And the minimum clearly is 1. So the range is just the maximum minus the smallest. So the range is 18. Now, since we want to have four classes, that's what it's asking, the most common thing to do would be to divide by 4. Well, 18 divided by 4 is 4.5. Now we want all the classes to have the same length, so therefore we're gonna round this to phi. So therefore the length of the classes is gonna be phi. So what do you mean by that? This is what we're gonna do. So the first class is gonna be from 1 to 5. The second class is gonna be from 6 to 10. The third one from 11 to 15, and the last one from 16 to 20. So that takes care of this part in which you create four classes. Well, what about the frequency? So now you have to count how many numbers lie between 1 and 5. So how many are between 1 and 5? Well, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this can be a little bit tedious, but it's not hard. So this one will be 6. If you do the same thing for the next one, this will be 10. You should check this, stop the video if necessary, and count this. Between 11 and 15 is 4. And between 16 and 20, you only have 1, which is a maximum, so this will be 1. Okay? Now, what about the class boundaries, which is the next part. The class boundaries are actually pretty easy to do. Here, the first class, let's focus on this one, is from 1 to 5. So technically what you do is you add 0.5 to each side, which means you add 0.5 here and subtract 0.5. So you extend or stretch the class. So therefore, 1 minus 0.5 will give you 0.5. And 5 plus 0.5 will give you 5.5. So that will be the class boundary. The next one, 6 minus 0.5, it should give you 5.5. This one will be 10.5, and so forth. So it will be 10.5, 15.5. This is 15.5, and this is 20.5. One way to check that you're doing the right thing is to check this part. This has to match. You can see this matches with that one, and so forth. So that's one way you can check that this is right. Now, to find the class boundaries, it doesn't mean that you always have to do 0.5 and subtract it or add it. It actually depends on the kind of data you have. So if the numbers are pretty big, like thousands, maybe you had to add 500 and subtract 500, and if the numbers are very small, then it probably had to do 0.005 instead of 0.5. So that depends on what kind of data you have. So you need to be careful with that part. Okay, so in this case, these are all whole numbers, so it makes sense to just do 0.5 up and 0.5 down. Now, how do you find the relative frequency? Well, let's go for each class. So for the first class, has 6. That's the frequency. Between 1 and 5, you have 6 numbers. Now, one symbol we're going to use a lot the whole semester is the following. This symbol, which is the summations, which is self-explanatory, which means you add everything. So if you add all the frequencies, this is 21, which is also the sample size or the size of the data set. Okay. Well, how do we find the relative frequency? Well, the total number is 21. The first class has 6. So this is your 6 over 21. If we write this in percent, this is around 29%. So you have to do this for each class. The next one will be 10 over 21, which is around 48%. The next one will be 4 over 21. Notice that we're dividing everything by 21. Why? Because the sample size is 21. So we do this, this is around 19%. And finally, 1 over 21, which is 4%. Make sure that you round this correctly, because sometimes you may round this slightly different. So at the end of the day, just count and make sure that everything adds to 100. Because this one could also be rounded to 5%, but then that will give you 101%. You cannot have more than 100%. So as you can see, to find the relative frequency is straightforward. It's the frequency divided by the total for each class. The cumulative frequency is a little harder, but it's still pretty simple. So cumulative, as you know, it means just keep adding things. So for the first class, you only have 6. So therefore, this is just 6 over 21. Nothing has changed. But then, if you add these two, now you're going to have 16. So it will be 16 over 21. For the next one, it will be 20 over 21. And then the last one always has to add to 1 or 100%. Remember that this was 29% by itself. But if you add this plus that, which is how we got this value, this will give you 77%. Now, if you add this and this and this one, it will give you 96%. And then finally, the last thing has to be 100%. So make sure you check that it gets to 100%. Now, the last thing is the midpoint, and in the coming chapters, we're going to use this for midpoint symbol, MP. To find the midpoint is relatively very easy, very, very easy. All you have to do is add the end of the classes, so 1 plus 5 is 6. It's just pure coincidence that this number is 6, okay? So this 6 and 1 plus 5 equals to 6 has nothing to do with them. So this is what you do, 1 plus 5 is 6. And then divide by 2. So 1 plus 5 divided by 2 is 3. So that's how you find the midpoint. The next one, the end of the classes is 6 and 10. So then this will be 6 plus 10 divided by 2, which will be the number A, and so forth. This one will be 11 plus 15 divided by 2. And that will give you 13. And then finally, 16 plus 20 divided by 2, which will give you 18. there is no need to add the midpoints. So the only ones you have to add are the frequency, the relative frequency, and the cumulative frequency. All right, so as you can see, this is very, very, very easy to find class boundaries. Like I say before, in statistics, all you do are 14s, add, subtract, multiply, and divide. And remember, you can use a calculator to do all of that. All right, so let's move on to the next example. All right, let's try a different example. And in case you didn't notice, the previous data was quantitative data. This one is qualitative, so things will be slightly different. So we still had to create classes. So in this case, you have not much choice. You had to create 4 classes. So this is giving you the data of 25 cars. So the B stands for BMW, the H is Honda, the N is Nissan, and the F is Ford. So the classes are going to be the car brands. So Nissan, Ford, Honda, and BMW. Then for the frequencies, you had to count each of them, just like we did before. So Nissan, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And then do the same thing for 4. So you can check that this one is 5. Honda is 10. And then there is only 3 BMWs. Like the problem is already telling you there should be 25. So just check that it adds to that. So when you sum all the frequencies, yeah, this is 25. So far, so good. Now, since this is a qualitative data and not quantitative, therefore it makes no sense to add or subtract 0.5. So the class boundaries for this one don't exist. So that makes the problem pretty easy. However, you do have the relative frequency. The first one will be 7 over 25, which is equals to 28%. The next one for 4, this should be 5 over 25, which is equals to 20%. The next one is 10 over 25, which is 40%. Remember, just use a calculator to check this. All right, so 40%. And the last one is 3 over 25, which is 12%, or 0.12. Now, the cumulative frequency, remember that this is supposed to add to 100%. Okay, just check that first. The cumulative frequency, you just keep adding all of them. So the first one is just 7 over 25. That hasn't changed. That was still 28%. The next one is going to be 7 plus 5. So it will be 12 over 25, which 48%. The next one is going to be 12 plus 10, which is 22 over 25, which should be 88%. And then finally, 25 over 25, which should be 100%. Just the way it should be. Remember, this is 1, which is equals to 100%. Now, the midpoint, again, because this is not quantitative data, this doesn't apply. So this is NA, because there is no class boundary, so therefore you cannot have a midpoint. That's it. So as you can see, for qualitative data, this is actually easier because you don't have to worry about this part or this part. Finally, in section 2.2, we will focus on 2 types of graphs, histograms and bar graphs, which, as you can tell, they look very, very similar. And this is related to the first example, and this to the second example we just did. As you can see, the main difference between the two, between a histogram and a bar graph, is that there is a space between the bars in here. Well, this one, there is no space, and you'll see why in 1 second. So to create a histogram, you go back to the classes. Remember, the classes we have was 1 through 5, 6 to 10, 11 to 15, and 16 to 20. And then the frequency we have was 6, 10, 4, and 1. But then we also have the class boundaries, which was this. So we're gonna use the class boundaries, the frequencies, and the frequencies to create the histogram. So remember, this was what we have on the last page or the last examples. So this is how you want to create a histogram. So here, let's put the class boundaries, which is should be from 0.5 to 5.5. And then this is 10.5, 15.5, and then 20.5. Then this one, remember, was the one that the class from 1 to 5, and the frequency was the number 6. This one, the frequency was 10. This one, the frequency was 4. And this one, the frequency was 1. So notice that this is quantitative data. So therefore, quantitative data is used to do histograms. So histogram represents quantitative data. And that's why they are connected, because the class boundaries are connected, as you can see here. Okay. Now, a bar graph is going to be for qualitative data. Qualitative data. And there is a space in between. So here, this one is going to represent Nissan. This one is Ford. This is Honda. And this is BMW. Remember the frequency. So this is the frequency, just like for this one. The frequency for Nissan was 7. The frequency for Ford was 5. For Honda was 10. For BMW was 3. Now, on the exams, you are not expected to create any histograms or bar graphs, because they take a while to by hand. But you should be able to just look at one and know what it means. And you should also know the difference between a bar graph and a histogram. Remember, the main difference is that one is for qualitative data, and the other one is for, sorry, this is for qualitative data, and this is for quantitative data. All right, so that's it for chapter 2.